well, with the same rules applied internationally as they do domestically. Two of the biggest things I see that a lot of brothers and sisters have when they come in back is, one, is documents. Make sure you know when you're going, you're planning in advance, you're spending a lot of money. Have your documents ready to go when you're going. Make sure that the dates are valid. You have a long time left on it. Same thing with the visas. Make sure that they're valid dates for you to leave and they're valid on your entry. This way there's no hiccups. Sometimes you will experience a long process when you're coming back. That's fine. It's gotten a lot faster than it used to be. If there's any hiccups or anything like that on the way back, just go with it. There's over 100,000 people that travel back on every given day, especially during the summer. So if you think that it's taking you a long time, it's fine. Just go with it. If they make you move from one line to the other, don't feel like they're doing that because you're a Muslim or anything like that. I'm a Muslim as well, and I work there. And we all want to make it easier for our brothers and sisters to travel. So that's why I'm giving you the advice. And secondly, as inshallah you embark on this journey to Hajj or Umrah, and you and your families are going to be doing it for the future travelers and stuff, we want you to know that when you're coming back, documents, if they're good to go, you're not going to have an issue coming back in. When it comes to your Zamzam water, your khajur, your dates, anything you purchase while you're there, you could purchase as much as water you want, or get as much as water you want, and dates. Just put them in your check bag. Do not put them in your carry-on, because what happens is a lot of people, they'll come from Saudi and they'll have their Zamzam water in their carry-on, in their check bag, or in their book bag that they're coming back from Saudi with. And then when they come back to the United States, that's fine. But now they're on a connection flight, like they're going to go from here to Houston, for example. Now they're going to have to go through TSA, and TSA's rule is you can't have that much water, so they will take the water. So if you have bulky items like water and stuff of that sort, just keep them in your check bags. It will make travel a lot easier. And once the brothers here finish with their presentation, we're going to be around for any questions and answers. We wish you guys a successful journey, and make dua for every brother and sister. And if you have any questions or you need any help or advice, we're going to be here for you to help you. Assalamu alaikum.
How many times a day do we pray? Okay. Please, inshallah.
Who entered?
Nobody. Okay. Thank you very much for the presentation. And so we have two things to go over: items checklist and the do's and don'ts. And then I'm going to open it up for Q&A. I have some questions already coming to me, and I will try to answer as much as possible. I have Brother Ahmed Muhammad with me to also answer, and people who are online can send the question to ask@darislam.com. I will try to put it all together and see how much we can answer. I know we're running over, but I have a tough task of keeping you entertained, inshallah. The purpose of the Pilgrim's Items Checklist is something to jog your memory when you are ready to take things, pack things for you. What should I take with me? So I have sectioned it off. In terms of documents, what documents do I need? Well, make sure you have your passport. When you receive your passport, open it up. Make sure you have the Hajj visa on it. If you are one of those carrying the green card, you will need to carry it with you, though nobody will want it from you, but you will need it to come back. Make sure you read your airline ticket. And this is the part. Take your proof of vaccination with you. They may ask for it over there. So keep it with you, but take it with you. So that's in terms of travel documents. Next question, people.
Vaccination, you're going to ask for it here at the airport.
Well, take it with you, basically. you know, the proof of vaccination, right? Okay. So in terms of cash, people ask me how much cash should I carry. Well, that's a very tricky question. If you're not planning to buy any gifts for me, then you don't have to carry much cash. Generally speaking, we cover pretty well everything. You've already paid for the sacrifice, so nominal expenses, you know, maybe you want to buy some snacks here and there, $500 is more than enough to actually take that as incidental extra expenses. Not to mention the fact that if you are going to require a wheelchair to do tawaf and sa'i, then you have to actually carry more for that. Because each time you do a wheelchair, you hire the guy to take you for tawaf and sa'i, there'll be three times. One for Umrah, one for Tawaf al-Ifada, one for Tawaf al-Wada. So that's approximately $500 right there just for Tawaf and Sa'i. But excluding that, you know, you have to take, when the cash is king, credit cards are accepted in major stores. There are some ATM machines, sometimes long lineups, sometimes they run out of cash until they fill it up again. But cash is king, and if you're going to take cash, make sure you take larger bills with you. Don't take 20s and 10s and 5s. Take the 100s and the 50s and make sure they are relatively new looking bills, because the money exchanger sits there, you give him cash, he looks at it, he much, no, not this one. Don't know what he saw in it, but so make sure that it's something that is acceptable to him, for example. And I'm going to go through, you know, what happens with your valuables when you're there. So these are for those who are packing for their ihram in their hand carry program 3A, B, and 1C, make sure you have the ihram and the accessories with you in your hand carry. It must also be a slipper or sandal. You cannot wear normal shoes with ihram. And something suitable, money belt. I don't use a money belt per se, but the reason I don't use a money belt because I'm not going to carry my cash and valuables to the haram in the first place. So I need a belt to tie my ihram, but not necessarily a money belt. So if you are going to, these are the things I need for ihram. For the women, of course, is the clothes that she's wearing, that's the ihram. There is no ihram garment specific to women, it's whatever she wears. If you're going to Mecca first, these things should be in your hand carry. So you can use this as the checklist. Do I have this in my hand carry, right? As far as personal needs are concerned, you know, typical toothpaste, toothbrush. I mentioned already I use a Dove unscented in a dollar store. You know, soap box, plastic soap box. Nail clipper, small scissor. I do ask people to take bath and hand towels. You don't need it in the build in the hotels, but in Mina you should have your bath towel with you. One small packet of Kleenex would do. You can buy them here, you can buy them in the pharmacy. And as I mentioned already, light cotton clothing. I've given you a link. Go to that link when you're about to pack. They have a long-term forecast for Makkah and Medina. You'll get some idea how hot it's going to be. And then you can pack accordingly, inshallah. As I mentioned already, that, you know, for women, clothes-wise, you know, take extra clothes with you, light clothes with you in Mina. Men can live with 3 sets of clothes. Women will probably require 4 or 5 sets of clothes in Mina, because you know, you will go through them over there, but they should be fairly light. You know, some people are suggesting you can take a bed sheet with you. I mean, next thing you know, you're carrying a suitcase instead of a hand carry. I just want to be very careful as to how much you take with you to Mina. Okay, now comes, I'm about to go to Mina and Arafat. Besides my roll-on, what should I have? As I mentioned, if you're going to stay the night in Muzdalifah, it's preferable that you take a sleeping bag with you. It's preferable the sleeping bag should not be any more than 2 pounds of filling. That sleeping bag will be in your checked baggage all the way to Saudi Arabia, and you'll probably use it for one night. That's it. And you'll probably donate it at the end. A lot of people use the sleeping bag in Muzdalifah, and when they leave Muzdalifah, they just simply leave their sleeping bag behind. You can do that, but the better thing to do would be to make the effort and take the sleeping bag with you to Mina. That evening, you step out of the camp and you'll see people sleeping on cardboard boxes on the street. What better time to do some sadaqah than the days of Hajj and going out and giving it to them with your own hand, rather than with the intention of dumping it because you don't want to carry it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you for your intention. If the effort you made to carry your sleeping bag back to Mina was so that you can give it a sadaqah, that's different than dumping it, because that the effort was, I don't want it. So take advantage of the days of Hajj to do as much good, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says, وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمُ اللَّهُ. Whatever of good you do, Allah is aware. Take advantage of that. You will require a carry-on bag, the typical bag that you take with you in the aircraft. You will need that for Mina. In addition, we'll give you a backpack. If sunglasses, it's pretty bright. I mean, if you cannot handle sun, then take sunglasses. And if you're taking a prescription glass, well, you know what? Take an extra set with you and take the next strap, the one, the string that goes on the glasses. In case you get knocked off, the glass doesn't fall on the ground. It simply hangs on your neck. Take that string with you and put it on the glasses. Prayer mat. For the women, we do provide a prayer mat in Medina. We give the women the prayer mat, we give the men ihram, for example. But you will need something for places to pray in Mina, also in Muzdalifah. So have a very light prayer mat. You can buy one in Medina if you want. Okay? And take a Quran with you, with the objective of being able to finish the Quran during this trip, so you're not stuck with idle thoughts, wrong thoughts, or idle discussions. You're concentrating in remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not going to cover the medical kit, but this is like some of the things. It's not what you need to take with you. It's a memory jogger. Do I need Gravol? If you're prone to air sickness, not, then don't take it. Do I need aspirin? Okay, my favorite brand is Tylenol. Okay, you might want to take that. So these are simply meant for jogging your memory. Can I take face mask, or can I wear face mask in the state of ihram? This is one of the questions. Let me answer it now. You absolutely can wear a face mask in the state of ihram. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay, so you can take it here. It's also available in pharmacy over there. I mentioned about the electrolyte tablets, but the most important thing that I want to mention to you is that if you are on prescription medicine, whether it's your statin drugs or your blood pressure medicine or your diabetic, for example, make sure you take sufficient quantity with you to last the trip. Don't count on buying it over there. If you lose it and we had to buy, that would be an emergency. But don't plan the emergency. Emergency is something that happens. Take with you sufficient quantity. And if you have the prescription label in your meds, it's much better. Because if somebody asks you at customs, what is this? The label is on it from the doctor, from the pharmacy that they put the labels on. If you require refrigeration of your diabetic insulin, so forth, especially in Mina, speak to us, because we can provide you a place where you can actually store it in the fridge. But what you need for that is you need a very small Tupperware-like container or a plastic bag that is sealed. So when you put your med in there, nothing else will go in there. You seal it, you put your label on it, and we'll actually store it for you. Right? And you can use it in Mina when it's hot. It'll be in the fridge until you require to use it. So we can make those kinds of arrangements, but take sufficient quantity. You can please take advice from your physician when it comes to what to do if you are diabetic or you have asthma or heart condition or blood pressure condition, how to handle that in hot weather. If you're allergic to specific drugs or have medical condition, write it on a piece of paper and do let us know. Do let your group leader know, look, I have these conditions, I want you to know that. And write it on a piece of paper. And the reason we say that is because we've had instances where somebody is simply collapse and we had no idea why. So how would we treat this person? We find out later on that he had these conditions. We'd rather know up front so we know exactly how to treat. MashaAllah, subhanAllah, we have tons of physicians that travel with us and they actually volunteer their services. So not only that we can get you physician, inshallah, over there, we can get you the specialist you're looking for, including psychiatrists if you need one. So you guys are falling asleep on me. Okay, all right. So I'm going to go into the do's and don'ts. This is important. The least baggage is better for you, right? You're allowed to take two pieces of checked bag from here and bring back two pieces. But if you can live with one, that's great. You can always buy another suitcase over there as such. But because at times it's the baggage that causes a lot of distraction. Anything that you're taking that is important, passport will be kept by the mutawif. So what do? You make copies of your passport. You leave a copy here at home. You leave another copy in a suitcase, separate from the original. So you at least have a copy. God forbid, if you lost it, we can go to the U.S. consulate and show them the copy. They'll help you get one, another one made. And keep it separate, especially the green card. Always wear your ID card. Make sure it's properly put together. At the airport here, then you can put it away when you land and have your ID card with you. Do not take any, you know, propaganda material, whether it's an audio something or DVDs and so forth. Sometimes they'll want to know what's in it. They're concerned about what your propaganda you're bringing into the country, especially in these days due to security, the height, if you will, the alertness. If you're going to go somewhere in a strange place, I'm in Arafat, and for some reason I want to go outside the gated compound, don't just do it. At least let us know. Let your group leader know I'm walking out, and don't do it by yourself. Go as a twosome. Like, there's nothing I'm telling you that's not common sense, right? As simple as that. If you're not oriented, if you're one of those guys that have difficulty getting your bearings straight, don't leave then. Don't go by yourself. It is not that difficult to go between the haram and the masjid. I guarantee you that. It's not that difficult. The best thing to do is halfway between the haram, halfway between the hotel and the haram, first time, stop, turn around, and pick a marker. You'll never forget it. Clock Tower building complex is huge. The hotels are inside the clock tower. It's in front of King Abdulaziz Gate. When you walk inside and you're going around the Kaaba, you think you've lost orientation as to which exit to take for King Abdulaziz Gate. Don't worry about it. There are signs inside that tells you this exit is for King Abdulaziz Gate. You cannot really get lost, right, as such. So do not take your cash and valuables everywhere. So here's what I do. When I first arrive there, whether it's Makkah or Medina, every hotel has a safety deposit box. You know, if you're there with your wife, not a problem. The room is to yourself. But if you're there with a shared accommodation where men are sharing a room or women are sharing a room, just agree on the four-digit code for the hotel deposit box and stick it in there. Stick your credit card, debit card, extra cash. Even when I go out and cash, you know, $200 and I get 750 riyals, I might want to just keep the 500 riyals in the safety deposit box and carry 250 riyals. Use common sense. Under no circumstances would I ever tell you that you should take any cash or valuables to either Masjid al-Nabawi or to the Haram. Because unfortunately, there are pickpockets. Not everybody goes with the intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? I'm just warning you. I've had sisters come to me and says, but I had kept it, the wallet was inside my purse and somebody opened. Yes, they're that good. They'll actually open up your purse and take the wallet from inside. It was always right in front of me. Don't take the chance. Why did you feel you have to take it with you in the first place when you have the ability to store it somewhere else? Make sure you are on time for group gatherings, because remember, if you're going to travel, you're traveling as a group, and don't be the cause of the delay in inconveniencing others. That's not doing good to others. Sometimes you'll be asked to gather at a specific time only to find out that it's delayed. And you might say, oh, you know, they're just saying it, get together at 9 o'clock, it'll be by 10. Don't do that, because we actually sincerely try to get you on that time. There are extenuating circumstances, traffic held up, something that causes us the delay, but you yourself should prepare for it. Otherwise, we'll never have a plan to execute to, right? And so when we give you the instructions, please follow that. You'll be asked to tag your luggage and put it out by 6 o'clock. You might come back and say, let's say you're going from Medina to Makkah. I'm going to use a real life example. When you arrive in Makkah, you can't find your luggage. You're really upset. You scream and yell and say, it was my luggage and so forth, so on. And then you find out that you didn't put it out in time outside your room in Medina. The guy came and left. You just stuck it at 10 o'clock at night. And it was still there when you left. Follow me? So you didn't really play your part. So just play your part. Tag it properly. Put it out on time. Don't, under any circumstance, you know, drink. Drink Zamzam water and maintain your fluid level. Your body will tell you when you're dehydrated. Just listen to it. You can tell when you have difficulty peeing, or it burns, or it's very dark. So listen to it. Listen for the signs and treat yourself. Avoid heavy food, and please pace yourself. A lot of people get excited. They're there for tahajjud. They are there for fajr. They don't fall asleep. And, you know, about 4 days later, you're flat out on your back because you're sick. Because you can't keep the pace. And as was mentioned by Dr. Maqsood, you need to know how to walk. 5 times a day between the hotel and the haram is enough of a walking that you don't do here. So start your exercise. Take advantage of the good weather. Start walking every day so you can get fit. Because there's a lot of walking over there. Tawaf and sa'i is not easy. A lot of walking. Going from Mina camp to the train station is a lot of walking. Standing in the train station, waiting for the train in Muzdalifah is standing for a long time. You have to build that up, inshallah. Okay? Avoid political handouts, right? Somebody's handing out a flyer, you're sensing, oh, there's a crowd gathering over there. You know, whatever you see is a crowd gathering over there, just go the opposite direction. Don't be inquisitive-minded to go and follow the crowd. There is no, that's not the reason why you went there. I want you to cooperate with your fellow pilgrims. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made Hajj obligatory at a specific time of the year, but it's obligatory on everybody who is eligible. It's not when you want it. It's always the month of Zulhijjah. And it's for everybody from all parts of the world. Do you think there's wisdom in that? That he's asking you to come together? Because there is no other display of brotherhood and sisterhood in the world as powerful as Hajj is. You may be with your friends and acquaintances and people that you know, but when the Iqamah is called in the Haram, what do? You fill the gap. You stand shoulder to shoulder. You may not know the person right to you or to your right or to your left. You may not even speak his language. Yet, when you pray, you bow together. You go to sujood together. You display that unity in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nowhere else can you find that. If you want to observe that and be awed by it, go to the haram for Salatul Asr, which is a silent prayer. When you have 1.5 million people there, there's always a sound, a buzz, because of the noise of the people. And then the prayers start. And the imam says, Allahu Akbar. Few seconds later, you can literally close your eyes and it will be very easy for you to pretend that you are alone because there's not a sound. Can you shut up 1.5 million people anywhere else, in any occasion, in any event? But they're not quiet. They're actually praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are in the state of ihram. There is a reason why you're there together. When he says, وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ, it involves everybody. He gives you the opportunity to do good, and so you take advantage of doing good. So know, get to know each other, not necessarily because they're from Dar es Salaam. And remember about your behavior during Hajj. Think in this term. You can say, well, those verses were revealed a long time ago. Maybe you'll run into difficulties. No, no. The Quran is forever till the day of judgment. Is it not? Am I correct? The Quran is till the day of judgment. So they had different set of difficulties than they have now. The fact he's telling you not to do these things is because you are likely to fall into it. Otherwise, why would he warn you? There is no one in this hallway, in this hall today, there is no one online that actually wants to go for Hajj and commit sins or argue or commit lewd acts. Anyone? Then why is he telling you? If you were to take this journey, then no, there shall not be any lewdness or committing sins. Because in this crowd, in this massive number of brotherhood and sisterhood, you're likely to fall into these things, and he's warning you about it. So watch out. There is a reason behind this thing. It's not just some verses Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions. Similarly, you'll get the opportunity to do good with others. Right? Reason I say that to you is because I want you to read this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as reported by Abu Huraira, that whoever removes a worldly grief from a believer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove from him one of the griefs of the day of judgment. Do you want that? So help out your fellow Muslims. and whoever alleviates the need of a needy person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not only alleviate the need for him in this dunya, but also in the akhirah. Hajj gives you the opportunity, besides completing the fifth pillar of Islam, these acts of goodness is part of that. That is your opportunity. That is the chance given to you. We have narrowed it down to the rituals only. It is not ritual. That is why everybody's asked to come at the same time for Hajj. If it was only rituals, you could do Hajj whenever you wanted to do, because you could perform the rituals any time of the year. There's a reason behind it. And whoever shields or hides the misdeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shield him in this world and the hereafter. So don't point out somebody's wrong behavior. Verily, every good deed is charity, and it is a good deed if you meet your brother with a cheerful look. You see some of these guys in Dar Islam is wearing this t-shirt called Smile, It's Sunnah. That's why. The least you can do is cheerful look. When the poor companions of the Prophet ﷺ said to him, alayhi salatu wasalam, that just because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give them the resources to do sadaqah, as in freeing the slave or donating something because they don't have the money, that they felt that it was being unfair to them. And that's when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, smiling is charity, kind word is charity. So don't think charity is something material. It's you. It's how you behave towards your fellow brothers and sisters. That is considered a charitable act. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that. And the last one is a very powerful one. I left it as the last slide. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the most beloved of people to Allah are those who benefit people the most. And the most beloved of actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting happiness in the heart of a Muslim. You think that if you were given the opportunity, you would avail that, not turn away from it. You would think of your brother more so than you'll think about yourself. You know, you have not attained faith unless you love for your brother that which you love for yourself. Isn't that a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? This Hajj presents those opportunities to you, left, right, center. So don't be just stuck with the ritual part. I'm trying to ask you to look at the broader view of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you will be among them. And your actions with them is just as worth as a good deed in the days of Hajj as it is for your own self doing your rites and rituals. And this part, the last part, is a long hadith. I've taken a portion of it. And to help a believing brother with his needs is more beloved to me, said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To help someone with his need is more beloved to me than performing or making itikaf in my masjid for an entire month. So we would rather say, I'm going to do my own umrah 10 times and I'm going to inconvenience everybody else is doing tawaf, even though I've done my obligatory one. That's what people do now. You see more people without ihram performing tawaf than in ihram. The ones in ihram are really struggling because they want to do over and over again. And this hadith says, to help someone with his needs is more dear to me than making itikaf in my masjid for an entire month. When I go there, I make umrah once. If I have to do tawaf, I will do it on the roof. If I feel like I have to do an extra tawaf, I will do it on the roof so that I do not inconvenience anyone. It is just as important to me that I'm helping them out, whether it's physically helping them out or not causing any issues for them. This is part of Hajj. This is the heart that you take with you. That's how you gain from it. You must understand that quantity is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking for. He's looking for quality. And the quality is not something that you can think logically. It comes from the heart. It's not the action, but the intention and the sincerity of the intention with which you do the action that matters. Neither the blood nor the flesh of the animal reaches me. What reaches me is the piety of the heart. I wanted to mention that to you because you will come across issues. So help your fellow Muslim brothers and sisters. Be selfless. Put them first. You have to be patient. I'm telling you now, you have to be patient. Whether it's a lineup, whether it's this issue or that issue, we don't have the solution for everything. All we're bringing with you is telling you that we are sincere in what we say we will do, and we'll do our best to do it. But there are many things beyond our control. Be very patient. What is the definition of patience? Pardon me? Well, we know that sabr means patience, but what is the definition of it? Can somebody give me a brief summary of it? Patience. Forgiveness. Do you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised something to every one of us? He says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. No soul shall be burdened except that it can bear it. So you cannot get more than what you can handle. So he's promised you that. So whatever comes your way, by the way, you might be able to handle more than I can, but it'll be according to what he's given you, will be different according to what I, but each one of us can handle it. You got that? So definition of patience is to do without that which you're allowed to do, but are unable to do. That's one definition. The other definition is to do without that which you can do, but you're not supposed to do. You understand that? The flip side of it? Certain things you can easily do, but Allah says don't do it. It's enticing you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says don't do it. You desire it, He says don't do it. You have to be patient without it. Just as much as I want to do this, and it is allowed for you to do this, but you can't reach it. You have to be patient without it. So be very patient. I'm going to say, if you're going for Hajj, be extremely patient. I'm walking you through a tar field here, right? Until your feet get stuck and the message gets across. Okay. Again, we're sincere in what we're trying to deliver. And I want to close this thing by saying that nothing happens without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being not only being part of it or being the source of it. So even though you intend to do this journey, make sure every day in your salah you turn to Him. Not to Dar Islam, to Him. To help us in completing this journey safely, and to accept our Hajj and our du'as, and to guide us in this dunya and be pleased with us. If He's pleased with you in this dunya, He's pleased with you in the akhirah. You cannot ask for anything more. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with you in this dunya and in the akhirah. You have a whole Dar es Salaam team here. If we have said or done anything that offended you, whether it's on the phone or email or here at present, I do sincerely seek your forgiveness, for I am seeking the same grace and forgiveness and mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as each one of you. I am just as much a servant as each one of you. All I am standing here and not over there is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with doing this for so many years. I don't even have the words to express my gratitude. And I want to make sure that I pass whatever I know on to you. If any one of this benefits you, that is benefit for me. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from me and from you. So I would like to now open it up for questions. I know that we're running into some time, so I'm going to limit the questions, but I'm going to start answering some of the questions. And number one is, can we use umbrella? The answer, if the question is, can you use umbrella in the state of ihram? The answer is yes. You cannot cover your head, but you can put something above your head. As a tent is above your head, so can an umbrella be above your head. Are coal packs abundantly available in Medina and Mecca? I think it'd be better if you carry it from here because the supply over there is not guaranteed. It's not heavyweight. You can put it in your check baggage. You're allowed enough to actually carry it because they're actually very dry. It's only until you actually open it up and you squeeze it that the reaction starts and it becomes cold. So it's not really cold when you buy it as such. Yeah, sure. Okay, give me whatever you want to sort out. How will Zamzam water be delivered to DC airport, and how will we carry it to US domestic flight? So first part of the question I can answer, Zamzam that we said we will give you is not given to you in Medina or Mecca or anywhere during the Manasik. It's given to you at the hotel, at departure time, at the airport, as you're about to check in for the return journey. The Zamzam is limited. They actually allow 1 5-liter Zamzam, which is similar to the box that was sitting over there. And it is allowed on the flight to your first destination. If you've checked your baggage to DC, it's free to DC. If you then take it on a domestic carrier, should not be an issue as a checked baggage, but your domestic carrier may charge you for that. Living in Louisville, Kentucky, the vaccine here is for people up to 55 years of age. I'm 63. Where and how to find the vaccine I should take? I'm not so sure what vaccine you're referring to. If it's referring to meningitis, it is something that you need to actually get it done here and provide us the proof, because that is a prerequisite for the visa to be granted to you. If it is some other vaccine, then maybe you can see one of us on the side so we can understand your question. But the core of the answer is, speak to your physician. He would know more than I would do, especially the one in Louisville, Kentucky. Do you provide laundry service? And I mean to say that, do Dar es Salaam provide laundry service? I'll be the first one to use it if they do. We don't provide laundry service, but we can help you as to where the laundromat is. I think one of the maps that I showed of Mecca showed you a local laundry. Generally speaking, laundry is available in the hotels that you're staying in. It's normally a same-day service. If you give it out at 9 o'clock, you get it back. It's a bit expensive, but good quality. If you give it outside, it's a bit cheaper, but watch out, because sometimes they cannot deliver to you in time, and you have to bear in mind when your luggage is being taken away and when the laundry should be ready. So we don't provide it. It's available out there, and we can give you more details about that later on. Who? Wrong, right? Are you allowed to wear face mask if you're sick during haram time? You're allowed to wear face mask anytime you want, including in the state of ihram. If you feel you need it, great. The best thing I find to avoid being ill, and I find 8 out of 10 people do fall ill during this period. One of the reasons is, there are several reasons. One, it's hot outside, air conditioning inside. Two, just because of the sheer amount of people, there's dust in the air. And it's the number three, you're using prayer rugs in a common area. And four, you're not keeping pace. You get less sleep there than you ever get over here. You walk more over there and exhausted than over here. So it wears you down. But one of the things you can do is, anytime you leave your room, you're not going to go anywhere else, touch any food, until you come back to your room and you wash your hands. Don't say, oh, honey, I'll see you at the restaurant right after Isha. No, you're going to go back to your room, you're going to wash your hands before you go to the restaurant. That is the source of most of the disease, right? Do you see a program 2 will go to Mecca Hotel after Hajj or not? I heard they will not do Tawaful Wada. Okay, so program 2's itinerary is very simple. Start in Medina, go to Aziziyah, do your Umrah, go to Manasik, after Manasik, back in Aziziyah for one night, and then back in your, and then you go to your Mecca Hotel for 6 nights. And then you leave. As far as Tawaf al-Wada is concerned, it's not an option. You must do Tawaf al-Wada. The only difference is program 2 is going to stay in the hotel in Mecca for 6 nights. So that Tawaf al-Wada is towards the end. It's the last thing you do before you depart. Everybody does Tawaf al-Wada. What is the recommended number of haram outfits we should take, and where we can buy more? I think I recognize his handwriting. This is a tricky question.
Okay. It's not mine.
No, Nazneen was. Where is she? Where did she go? Okay. Number of haram outfits. This is a lady's perspective. So let me tell you, lady's perspective. As I said, you will need more so in Mina and Arafat. Maybe you'll take 4 or 5 sets of clothes. But the rest of the clothes, generally speaking, people buy it from here. They take here. But if you don't have the abayas, you can buy them over there. But whatever you wear, make sure it's baggy, it's loose, whether it's shalwar kameez or whatever you wear as such. Ladies wear baggy pants and shirt too, but the abaya covers it up, for example. The number of outfit depends on and how many you need to use over there, but more importantly is during the manasik, at least you should have four or five outfits.
So basically, brothers, in terms of ihram, mm-hmm. the state of ihram is different than the actual ihram clothes.
So correct? You can actually be in the state of ihram with one outfit. You can shower and change into another outfit and remain in the state of ihram. Ihram is the state or the intention. The changing of the outfit doesn't change the ihram. So you can be wearing one set of clothes. You feel like you want to shower and change. Do so. Don't use any perfume products. Don't pull your hair out and put on another outfit. You're still in the state of ihram.
This is for men. Okay?
For the men, same thing. Men feel like, okay, if I'm come from Medina, I'm going to do Umrah, and then 2 days later, am I wearing the same ihram? Will it not be dirty? The idea behind dirty is that it is soiled. It's najasa. Dust is not dirty. Can I repeat that? Dirt and dust is not dirty. For when there is no water for wudu, what do you use? Dirt. How can it be dirty? The Prophet ﷺ and the companions, when he made Hajj, they left Medina on the 24th of Dhul-Qa'dah. Listen to this carefully. They made their niyyah and ihram in Dhul-Hulayfa, outside of Medina. And they traveled for 9 days on foot and on camel till they arrive on the 4th of Dhul-Hijjah. You think they could change the ihram with a shower every day? It was dusty. It was dirt. And that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be. Lower yourself. Be humble. Show who you really are. Don't try to say, well, I'm going to change. It's what's inside that matters. As long as it's not soiled with bathroom stuff, it doesn't matter if the ihram is no longer white. As long as it's clean. And dirt is not najasa. Okay? For the men, about the outfits, I will only tell you because it's one of those personal questions. I'll tell you what I do personally. The pants and shirt that I wear in the plane is the only pant and shirt that I take. I'm at home with a thawb and a pajama at home. That's what I do at home. So I do the same thing. I'll take 5 sets with me. As soon as I'm out of ihram, I'll put one on. And when I'm on my third one, I'll get the other one laundered. So I'm ready. I'll keep one to wear on the day of Eid when I come back from Muzdalifah. So that's the 5 set that I use. That's it. When I travel with my wife, I don't get the whole suitcase. She gets the suitcase and a half, I get the half suitcase. He's saying you're glad you get a half. We're flying DFW, do not luggage all the way to Medina. If you're flying from any international port of departure and the flight is transiting in Dubai, but going to Medina, you can check your luggage all the way to Medina. It is only when you're flying from a local airport here to an international port of departure here that you should not check the luggage from your local airport to Medina. Do you understand the difference? I'm in Columbus, Ohio. I'm taking my international flight from JFK. Should I check my luggage in Columbus, Ohio all the way to Medina? The answer is don't do that. Check it into JFK, pick it up from JFK, check it again in JFK. But if I'm in JFK and I'm going on Emirates, would you stop in Dubai, check it all the way to Medina, not a problem. That's the difference. What if my hair falls out while I'm in the state of ihram? You can see me or somebody else. You know what? Tomorrow's session on the fiqh of Umrah, that's when you ask this question. Now, it all depends on what you mean by hair fall out. I don't have that issue, so I don't. It's very difficult for me to answer that question. My issue is that it doesn't grow back. Does Dar es Salaam require original of green card for visa processing? Yes. The consulate of Saudi Arabia requires the original green card.
We don't like it.
For processing. We don't want it. We don't like it. We don't want to take the responsibility, but we're forced to do so because they want the original produced. It's not Dar es Salaam.
But we don't request it in the beginning because we don't want to hold it for about 2 or 3 months. So you might get an email from us if you hadn't sent us the original green card within the next few days to send it to us. We take it and we tape it 20 times onto your passport to make sure that it doesn't come off and you get it back safely.
I just want to add something which happened last year. So when you get your green card, inshallah, back from Dar es Salaam with your visa, it will be taped on your passport. Take it off. Don't submit your passport. Don't surrender your passport when you arrive there with your green card in it. As I mentioned, your green card is only for visa. Once you get it, it's in your possession all the way. The next time you'll produce a green card for some officer to inspect will be at Jeddah Airport, where they will want to know whether you have the correct visa or you're authorized to enter the United States. That's it. Can we have our bath at Doha for Ihram? You know, the transit airports like Abu Dhabi or Doha or Dubai, they have these lounge for, you can go in there and you can pay some dirhams and so forth and take a bath. You can do that. I've seen some free ones too and I've actually used them. The problem is that you cannot rely on them. What if your flight is late? What if the time you have for transit time is 2 hours, off from one flight, run to the next flight? So the best thing is to physically prepare yourself here. Take your ghusl here. Now, if you happen to be in Doha and you have 6 hours to kill and your ihram is still in your hand carry, you want to take another shower? Go ahead. But don't say, I'm not going to take a shower at home. I'm going to do it over there. You understand the difference what I'm saying here? Very clear difference. If you find it, take the shower. But can you do it? Yes, you can. Right? If you're staying overnight in Doha, no problem. You'll do the ghusl over there anyway. Where do men go for shaving of the head? And it is after Jamarat. The barbers, Dar es Salaam will have barbers in our camp in Mina when you come back from Muzdalifah. After you have thrown the 7 pebbles in Jamaratul Aqaba, you can get your head shaved, but no, there will be lineup. There's only so many barbers, right? So here's what I do. I chill in my tent. I wait till the line to die. I wait till the bathrooms are free. It gets hot. By the way, there is no hot water tap over there because it's natural. As a matter of fact, it's so natural that you're looking for the cold water tap because the PVC pipe, the water gets really hot. So I actually take my ghusl to come out of ihram sometime just about an hour before Maghrib. Let everybody get done. I'm not in any rush. I don't mind being in ihram, going to the barber at 2 o'clock in the afternoon to get the haircut. But the barbers are in the camp. And it is after Jamarat. It's a question about qasr. Qasr means to shorten. So if you're a traveler, you're allowed to shorten. But there are differences among Hanafis and others as to whether you can combine them or not. But it is consistent with every madhab that you can shorten them. Right? Whether you combine them or not is another story. The only place we know there is no ikhtilaf is in Arafat and in Muzdalifah, regardless of which madhab you follow. Dhuhr and Asr is combined and shortened in Arafat, and it is combined, shortened and combined in Muzdalifah. The rest, Hanafis believe you cannot combine them, but everybody believes you have to shorten them. I hope I've answered the question because all it says is Qasr Salah, so I'm trying to be I don't know what he means. Cameras and videos.
So you answered that question, so we give you a tasbih for that.
Yeah, do I get a tasbih?
Yes, you do.
Okay. Cameras and videos in the haram. Generally speaking, I've seen people with the handheld cameras. They go in and they're taking pictures and so forth. If you do it in front of a security guy, he will stop you. But I know that in Medina, if you're walking in and you are happens to be a woman, and you walk into the Masjid al-Nabawi and there is a woman guard, she will not allow you to enter if you are holding a camera. They don't want you to go inside to taking pictures. But men, they go inside, they take pictures. They take pictures with their iPads. But if you do it in front of somebody, you know, he'll say, don't do it. And he might just not like it, but try not to. How husband and wife will get together from Mina tents and go to for Arafat? Very simple. The compound in Mina is one big campsite. It's inside that it's divided. You will actually not only meet with each other inside, you can actually sit down and have dinner together if you want. So you will come to an agreement because both of you have phones, you have WhatsApp. When the time comes, I'll meet you over there, but don't leave without each other. Don't be one of those that I find every year, brother, okay, my wife is somewhere, or the wife says, I don't know where my husband is, and next thing you know, they meet somewhere, right? But so when you are traveling and you are a family, you are a mihram for your woman, be the mihram for your woman. Make sure he is with you in tawaf, going from Mina to Arafat, Arafat to Muzdalifah and back. Don't assume that she is going to go on her own and she assumes that you're waiting for him. Don't do that. Just come to an agreement. There will be a meeting point. If you're a husband and wife, you're in the same group. You'll not be in separate groups. And your group leader will be the same person. So the group leader is a person to communicate with. There'll be a meeting point where you meet outside the camp before you move on, but stay together. Program 2B will be performing Umrah on the 7th of Zulhijjah. Do we perform Hajj Tamattur or Hajj Qiran? Over the years, people have done both. But quite a few people, I would say a majority of the people ended up performing Tamattur than Qiran. You're going to leave in program 2B from Medina according to the EBIC. What time? Somebody gets a wallet this time if we can answer that. What time are we departing from Medina in program 2B? It's in the e-book. 2B, specific to you. Better than Tasbih. Yes, sister. 8 a.m.? Who said 8 a.m.? No, it's not 8 a.m. 2 p.m. This gentleman gets the wallet. 2 p.m. The reason for it is because you're going to come to Azizia, 8 hours plus. You're going to check in. You're going to have dinner. Then we're going to go to the haram to make umrah. You're already in ihram. And you're going to go back. You can stay in the state of ihram, but the majority of the folks chose not to be in the state of ihram. So you'll shower, change, you will rest. When you come back from the haram into Azizia, 7th of Zulhijjah, it'll be around 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. It also happens to be a Friday, and I wouldn't encourage you to pray Friday prayers. You will be exhausted. You will not be able to manage the manasik. My plan is to go. I'll be with you. I'm in program 2 operations. I'll be with you. I will perform my umrah, and I'll come back. I'll sleep. I'll pray Zuhr in Surah Jum'ah. If I can go to the masjid nearby, I'll pray Jum'ah. Because for a traveler, Jum'ah is what? I don't hear the but though. Somebody will say, but brother. Brother, this is important. This is Jum'ah over there. It's important. I must pray Jum'ah in the haram. Right? I've had those things. But brother, you know, I know it's not required, but there is a but somewhere in here. The only way I can answer is this. What day was it when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Arafat? What was that? It was Jum'ah. Did he pray Jum'ah in Arafat? What did he pray? Dhuhr and Asr. Does that answer your question? Did he not know the benefit of praying Jum'ah? Especially during Hajj days? But he didn't pray Jum'ah. He prayed Dhuhr and Asr. So use your wisdom, not your emotion. Understand. Program 2 has a second Jum'ah on the 14th, inshallah. We'll make some arrangements for that. But generally speaking, on the 7th of Zulhijjah, I'll come back, get out of ihram, get some rest. The next morning, take a bath, put on ihram and go. But if you want to do Quran, stay in ihram. It's up your choice. Can we use socks for sa'i in tawaf? This is a gender-specific question. For a woman, not an issue. They can wear socks. They can even wear clean shoes for tawaf. They can wear clean slipper for sa'i. There is nothing wrong with wearing shoes in the haram as long as it's clean. So, but for a man, no. In the state of ihram, you cannot wear anything on your feet except for the fact that it's a slipper that allows your heel bone and some of the front bone to be exposed. So there is no socks for men. But for a woman, she can wear socks, she can wear shoes, she can wear slippers. What is the ruling of wearing a knee brace in the state of ihram? I am not a mufti, but I can tell you what a sheikh answered last year to a similar question. If it is a medical need and you must wear it, and you know you're not allowed to wear it, his answer was, wear it, but offer a fidya, offer a sacrifice. You can answer, ask this question again in the forum, and I will make sure that it gets answered by Muhammad Salah with a response. Some of them I have to answer. Can we shave in ihram?
Shave what?
Are you referring to shave? If you're referring to the facial shave, then I would suggest to you that you should grow a beard even without ihram, because this is sunnah. No, you cannot shave in ihram. You cannot cut hair, you cannot cut nails, you cannot shave in ihram. Can we change the ihram daily? Yes, you can change the ihram, I already mentioned it. Use unscented soap. Can we shower every day? You can shower as many times as you want. If you're going to Mina after Umrah or arrival, necessary, or can we skip Mina to go to Arafat? If you're in program 6, you're given both options. You can do either or. By the way, you don't have to make the decision now. If you're in program 6, in Medina, you have a few days. You can make that decision at that time. Speak to the sheikh at that time. Some of the same questions, speak to the sheikh. Also speak to the group leader. Say, I want to go to Mina on the 8th, or no, my heart says I should be there. Then follow your heart, because you're allowed to do both. Should I return to Mina from Muzdalifah at midnight with females, child, when I'm the wali? Definitely, for women and children, you should come back. And if you're the wali, you are excused to come back as well. Again, you can ask the sheikh. If you wanted to stay, you can too. But if she wants to come back, then you must come back with her as the mahram. Okay? How many nights stay in Mina? Mandatory. You're there for the 10th night, the 11th night, and the 12th night. You're leaving on the 13th of Zulhijjah if you're in program 2, 4, 5, and 1. Can I offer Hajj for a diseased parent? You can offer Hajj Badal for someone else, for another person, provided you have already done your own mandatory Hajj. Is insurance necessary? It's a personal question. Do you need it? It's your question, it's your decision. I cannot really advise you one way or the other. How many times Sa'i is mandatory? Again, if you're making Hajj Tamattu, you will do Sa'i with Umrah, you will do Sa'i with Tawaf al-Ifada. Tamattu or Qur'an. So again, if you're doing Qur'an, then you do Sa'i with Umrah, then you don't do Sa'i with Tawaf al-Ifada. Again, there is ikhtilaf in that, different between the madhab. Some madhab, the Hanafi madhab will say, no, you have to do Sa'i still after Tawaf al-Ifada. So it depends on what you follow. But there is no more than 2 Sa'i. And you don't fast yourself on the 9th day of Zulhijjah. If you are yourself in Arafat, you are not the one to fast. People who are not there with you are the ones to fast. You are not going to fast. It's not actually, you should not be fasting on that day. Okay? Any questions online? Yes, sir. For what? If you need to buy a gift from me, how much you should take with me? Well, let's have a conversation outside. The best gift you can do, give me and give those who are serving Darussalam, and I'm sincere in this, is to remember us in your dua. There is nothing better that you can give us. Subhanallah, as I said, we're grateful and honored that we are actually able to do this. And you can actually honor us more by seeking the same grace that you're seeking for yourself. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the same. That's the best gift you can buy. Right. Yeah.
The viewers online didn't see the ID.
So the viewers online did not see the ID card. They saw the passport label. This is the label that is in lieu of the Hajj draft. The purpose of showing you this is to let you know that one or the other will be on your passport as a payment for Hajj draft. Don't remove it. And the ID card that I showed, the front and back that you missed, the front one shows the name, the group number, the program, nationality. The back one shows the hotels, the hotel phone numbers, and the room serial number that allows us to locate your actual room number easily from the list. And at the bottom is actually the emergency contact number. And then, of course, the luggage tag, front and back of the luggage tag that you will get, that should be on your checked luggage, not your hand-carry luggage, when you check in your luggage here at the airport in USA. Okay? So I'm going to end this, inshallah. This is recorded. The slides will be, inshallah, within a week in the forum. And you can listen to the recording. So before I leave, I do ask you to stay for Asr prayer if you have not prayed Asr. But let's end this thing properly. Imam, I don't see Imam Ghulam Rasool. It's okay. Let's. You know, there's one thing that is free, and that is dua, right? And subhanAllah, you know, ask him and he will provide you. There's no question about it. And call him by any of his attributes. And that's why he actually tells you that, subhanAllah. While he's looking for the imam, I'm going to take 5 more minutes and give you, you have 5 minutes? You're bored. Okay. This is something that a sheikh told me a long time ago. He said some of the verses in the Quran can never fully be understood if you just read the meaning of it. It is actually meant to be experienced to understand it. If you're reading the Quran, you might find this verse is out of place because all of a sudden the theme changes out of nowhere and you think, doesn't flow. Why is it there? Because reading it doesn't explain it. Experiencing it explains it. And so there is a verse pertaining to Hajj that falls into this category. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek help. You say, يَاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَيَاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. No, we worship you, we seek your help. Here he's telling you to seek help. With what? Sabr wa salah. Right? With patience and with salah. Both are difficult. Salah is difficult. وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا لِلْخَاشِئِينَ. Except for those who are khashin. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ السَّابِرِينَ. The word inna is a definitive article. Have no doubt. Allah is with the sabirin. Don't ever doubt it. Then he goes on to say, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. And you will be tested with what? Khawf, fear. وَالْجُوعِ, with hunger. وَنَقْسٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ, loss of wealth. وَالْأَنْفُسِ, loss of health. Fear, hunger, loss of wealth, loss of health. وَالثَّمَرَاتِ, the fruits of your deeds will be taken away from you as a test. Then he says to the Prophet ﷺ, وَبَشِّرِ السَّابِرِينَ. O Muhammad, give good news to those who are patient. Who are they? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. Those are the ones when a calamity strikes them. قَالُوا. They say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. It's not the saying of it, it's the acknowledgement of it. Indeed, for sure, to Allah it all belongs, and unto Him is the return. You acknowledge that. You feel it inside, you acknowledge that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. Upon them is my blessing and my mercy. Such people. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. And such people are the ones who are rightly guided. All of that flows nicely. Be patient, you'll be tested. What do you think is the next verse after that? It doesn't flow until you experience it. Do you want to know what the next verse after this is? The very next verse. إِنَّ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. Whoa, what does being patient and being tested got to do with Safa and Marwa? Because when you do that, when you go there, the types of difficulty and tests that you have to sometimes go through, then it hits you as to why that verse is there. That's the very next verse. إِنَّ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. It is tied to being tested and to being patient with a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is with those who are patient. He blesses them, His mercy pours on them, and they are rightly guided. When they acknowledge when they're being tested, that hey, nothing belongs to me, it all's from Him, and unto Him is the return. Jazakumullahu khairan. I will end this, but I'm going to ask Sheikh Inam Ghulam Rasool to come and do a closing dua, and then we'll have the adhan and the asr prayers, inshallah. So from me, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka. I'll be hanging around.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen us to be among his guests. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم العمار والحجاج وفد الله. Those who come to perform Umrah and Hajj are among the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إن دعوه أجابهم ونستغفروه غفر لهم. When they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah responds to their duas. And when they ask forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them. My brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, all of us are invited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perform Hajj this year. I want to take this opportunity to congratulate all of us. And at the same time, I want to make dua that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept and honor our journey, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Hajj Mabrur. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability and strength that we are able to perform all the manasik of Hajj the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has performed. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all in abundance at every step that inshallah we are going to take towards the performance of Hajj. I will ask you, let's make dua and seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings. But I want to assure you, the months of Hajj have already started. Shawwal, Zilqada, Zilhajj are the months of Hajj. You have made intention, irada, niyyah. You are good to go for journey. So in the code of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are considered as Haji already. Your door of hasanat has been opened already. So pray, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah honors our du'as, our supplications, our good intention. And inshallah, during the month of September, coming September, we are able to perform Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us siha, afiyah, and strength. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may grant us Hajjun Mabrur. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad wa ashabi Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وادخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما يا رب العالمين. All of us are here, and many, many of our brothers and sisters at home are part of this gathering. We make dua for ourselves and for all those who in their homes are part of this program. Ya Rabbal Alameen, everything is in your knowledge. Innahu alimun bidhati sudur. Ya Allah, that's your status. Inna Allaha ala kulli shay'in qadeer. Ya Rabbal Alameen, that is your position. But yes, we all here at home ask you, Ya Allah, grant us the ability, courage, and strength that we are able to perform Hajj, Ya Allah, the way you have commanded and the way your Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam has performed Hajj. Oh Allah, all of us have made irada, niyya, and we are about to do amal. Ya Rabbal Alameen, grant us the ability to perform all the good a'mal and manasik Hajj during the days and months of Hajj, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, we are weak, but you are the most strong, Ya Rabbal Alameen. We ask you, we beg you to grant us siha, afiyah, courage, Ya Allah, grant us the capacity and capability that we are able to perform the Hajj. And Ya Allah, we seek your acceptance of our Hajj, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Darussalam, our host, makes every year beautiful arrangements. The entire team of Darussalam, we pray for them also. Ya Allah, grant them the ability that they can host us, they can serve us, Ya Allah, and whatever service, khidmah, they are providing for the Hujjaj, O Allah, honor their khidmah for the Hujjaj. Ya Allah, all the Hujjaj who are, inshallah, invited by you from all over the world, Ya Allah, accept their Hajj. But Ya Rabbil Alameen, all of us who are making the Hajj through Darussalam, all of us, the ummah of your Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Allah, grant us hajjun mabrur. Ya Allah, grant us your rahmah. Ya Allah, grant us barakah. Ya Allah, grant us al-maghfirah. Ya Allah, grant us the best of this world and the best of hereafter. Ya Allah, we ask you to grant us patience. Inna allaha ma'asabirin, you are with those who exercise patience. Ya Allah, we have taken up the journey of hajj, which requires patience and sabr at every step of this journey. O Allah, we ask you to grant us sabr, Ya Allah. We ask you to grant us patience, Ya Allah. O Allah, grant us the ability that we are able to exercise perseverance throughout this journey, Ya Allah. We are able to make exercise of sabr, Ya Rabbil Alameen. O Allah, you have commanded in the Quran, you have said, وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمُهُ اللَّهِ وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ زَادِ التَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Ya Allah, we are naqis, but you are the most perfect, Ya Allah. We seek your rahmah for us, Ya Allah. We seek barakah from you, Ya Allah. We seek strength from you, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And we ask you to honor all the efforts we are making throughout this journey, Ya Rabbil Alameen. O Allah, grant us the thawab and blessing of Umrah and Hajj. And as your Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man dakhala fi hadha al-bayt dakhala fi hasana wa kharaja min maghfuran lah. Ya Allah, grant us maghfirah throughout. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, raja'a kama waladathu ummu. When people return from Hajj, they are as pure as the day was born. Ya Allah, we seek for your forgiveness, Ya Allah, your maghfirah. And Ya Allah, we ask you to grant us the total purification, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And Ya Allah, grant us the ability that we are able to come back and live a life of taqwa, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, when we return, we seek your guidance, Ya Allah. When we come back, we are able to begin a new life of Islam, the life of following your Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow a new life, to seek for taqwa, for your rida, and for your pleasure, Ya Rabbil Alameen. O Allah, grant us the best of this world and the hereafter. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Kareem, Anta waliyuna fi dunya wal akhirah, tawaffana muslima wa alhiqna bis salihin wa adkhilna bi rahmatika fi ibadika salihin. Allahumma ajirna minan nar wahshurna ma'al abrar. Allahumma inna nas'aluka ilman nafi'a wa rizqan wasi'a wa amalan mutaqabbila wa shifaan min kulli da. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al'afwa wal 'afiyya والمعافاة الدائمة في الدين والدنيا والآخرة والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. آمين. Thank you very much. جزاك الله.
جزاك الله خير, brothers and sisters, for attending the seminar. We hope that it was as beneficial as we planned, inshallah, for your trip. Just a few reminders. Fiqh session tomorrow, hosted by Qalam Institute. It is online, qalamhajj.com/live. It was sent to everyone, I believe. It starts at 11 a.m. Central Time, inshallah. Again, Sister Manahil, can you raise your hand? Sister Manahel is a group leader with Program 6. So if you have any questions, if you're Program 6, Sister Manahel is standing there waving her hand. Program 2, Brother Haidar, is on the right-hand side. If you could raise your hand, please. Brother Muhammad Fathi, Program 1. Brother Shahid, Program 2 as well. Program 4 is Imam Rasul, inshallah. And Program 5, I believe, is Brother Sammy is in the back over there. And if you have any questions for Program 3, I'm here as well. All right. Jazakallah khair. Brother Azhar is going to make an announcement, inshallah. No? That then, huh?
Okay, folks, don't go away. Make sure you pray Asr before you leave, inshallah. This is simply an invitation.